Hi, my name's Kevin Hicks. Welcome to my history channel, The History Squad. Today, we're going to talk about and show you medieval arrows, concentrating on the arrowheads and go through some. I've actually got some originals that were dug up in France. So without further ado, let's crack on. So we got here, straightforward medieval style arrow. We can't call it a medieval arrow because as far as I know, there are none left. Apparently there was one in the tomb of Henry V, but later on was disproved. Now these are very basic. This one is ash. It has a piece of cow horn through what you call the nock, and the fletchings are whipped, and on the other end is a broadhead. So what we'll do is we'll start with the broadheads. This, much to my amusement, because I'm a naughty boy, this is the type 16. Actually, it's my favorite broadhead. It's swept back, it's tanged, so you can't pull it out. This is a nasty piece of work, yeah? And this is where I kind of get the gigglies, because if you imagine, let's say, the Battle of Agincourt, yeah? And you're a French soldier, you're marching forward, and the terrible hailstorm of arrows comes by, and some archers, lucky enough, you know, maybe they are archers belonging to one of the knights, you know? They've got the Type 16s, really good arrows. And as you're marching forward, oh, and you've been shot right in the groin. Now, the only way they're going to remove this is they're going to have to push it all the way through, which is where my comedy takes over. I am sorry, but I've got to tell you this. Can you imagine, right? Bear with me. French one. Oh, no. And your friend goes, oh, Pierre, vous tirez des vecs en gros flèche des Anglais. Excuse my French. Oh, Pierre, you've been shot with a big English arrow. Oui, je regarde, I can see. Oh, says it's a Type 16. No. And you imagine after the battle, you're standing there, oh, you're lying there. Oh. And the priest comes up and goes, oh, that's going to cost you a few bob, that is. That's an extraction that's going to push all the way through your groin. So the Type 16, it's a nasty piece of work because as it flies through the air, it rotates. And as it goes into the body, it actually twists. Now, I've done this on the body of a pig, and it's gone through the flesh and the bone, twisting. So to get it out, you've got to open up the wound, cover up those tang bits there, and then try and pull him out, or you've got to push him all the way through. Excruciating. The Type 16, nasty. But I've got some others. Here we have a large broad head. Some call it a swallowtail, but it kind of got me into trouble. I say trouble, it was a performance at Warwick Castle. And I'd been told that these could be used against horses. To me, it's just a hunting arrow, yeah? But there I am on stage with all my arrows. I'd already done my shoot, and I hold this up and I say, here we have what I regard as a hunting arrow, but it can be used against horses, so like a horse arrow. And as I go any further, out of these dozens and dozens of people, a hand shot up. And as I look down into the audience, because I was up on a stage, it was an American lady, part of a tour group, and her husband standing right next to her just went, oh no. And I actually saw him, oh no. And there was a groan went up from the rest of the group. So these people had been through some stuff. And I, being Kevin the Bowman, I mean, yes, madam, how can I help you? And everybody turns to look at this woman and she said, so that's a horse arrow, right? And I went, yes, madam. How'd the horse shoot the arrow with the hooves? Her husband yelped. The rest of the audience fell about laughing. The woman, though, didn't. And I had to explain to her that actually it was for shooting the horse. Thank you, she said. Her husband just walked off into the distance. Bless him. Broadheads. Hunting. I've got another hefty one. You know, I mean, these are meat slicing. But if you're on the battlefield, you're going to have a lot of trouble shooting these. You've got to have somewhere to store them. Are they in your arrow bag? You can't pull them out. Yeah, the Type 16s are going to be difficult enough. But you have a look at this one here. This, just a simple crescent moon or a fishtail. Now, I've used this practicing, and it is purely and simply a hunting arrow. And it's very accurate. But if you hit the soft flesh of an animal, it literally shreds it and fetches the beast down, bless it. These are as ancient as time. Made from bone, from flint, stone. Man has used these for fetching animals down. It's a hunting arrow. But I've got one broadhead here, which is purely and simply, pour la guerre. It's for war. Let me just put these down. This is the incendiary, or as they would say in French, excuse my French, incendiaire. It's a complete piece. The whole end of it is actually steel. And I managed to get myself a recipe for an incendiary, a fire arrow, from none other than Richard Head, the bowyer. Years ago now, long, long time ago, and Richard sent this to me, and it was from Germany, and I copied it. And basically, you have some felt, some woolen felt, and as you roll it into a sausage, you make sure that inside the core, there is gunpowder. And I was licensed in those days, and you bind it on. And then there was a recipe for making like a pitch, a tar, which I did, and it dried solid. And I figured out you could carry these by the box load, not fixed to arrows, just a box of incendiaries. And somebody says to me the one day, have you ever used it? No. And there hangs the tale. Chepstow Castle, school group. Nice Welsh school that I used to go to many, many years. The teacher there, he was became a very good friend. No names, no pack drill. I'm not going to tell any tales, except his name was Trevor. Oh, did I say that? So I've got it set up and I've told everybody concerned what we're going to do. So the custodian there, Roger, we've shut all of the doors and we've got safety buckets of sand and all the things. And I'm going to shoot diagonal across the courtyard. All the children, all the school children are up in the battlements. Teachers are standing by. Trevor is briefed. Don't touch the arrow, just pour the sand over it. I hold this over the flame and it doesn't catch. I'm looking at it and the kids are getting impatient and everybody's waiting. The castle's been closed down for a few minutes. And then I noticed that fire is dripping off the end, almost like a liquid fire. And then it dawned on me that the actual coating itself, once you get it going, is going to burn. So I aimed, glove on my hand, protected my bow, and I shot diagonally across the courtyard. And it left this trail, this wisp of smoke, and hit the ground. Bump, it starts to burn. It's not a great big fire. It's concentrated. And I'm amazed at this. Wow. Yeah. And then I expected the sand to be tossed onto the arrow. But no, the brave teacher steps forward. He pulls the arrow out of the ground. The ground is on fire now. Not very much, but enough. And he stamps on the fire and sets fire to his shoe. Because what we've got is a bit of liquid fire going on. He then waves the arrow, trying to put it out. And he is spreading fire all around. Everybody rushes to, takes the arrow, drops it on the ground, sand to put everything out. We sit him down and he was all right after a cup of tea. However, I had a look and the amazing thing was the arrow itself, only about a third of the fuel had burnt down. So later on, I did some experiments. Nobody else there, just me. And I lit the arrow, shot it. It burned for 20 minutes. So you imagine one of these going into the castle or into the town. As this goes into the roof, whether they be wooden shingles or thatch, this is going to burn for a long time. Could even drop down inside. It's not a fire arrow as the films would have. This is a true incendiary. And I can tell you, it works. So, bodkin arrowheads. These are real ammunition from history. Medieval ammunition, yeah, as I call it. These are superb. This is a long bodkin. It's a little bit shorter than it was when it was first made because I broke the tip off. But this has gone into lots of breastplates and bits of metal, only a centimeter or so, but it's punctured it. It's good. Yeah, I've got a heavier one here. This Type 14 style bodkin, heavy, will knock a man down. But chain mail to these is no resistance. And of course, if you've got padding on, these are going to get into it. If they don't go through it, they're going to make it uncomfortable. But surprising for me is this little boy here, which I am told is an original. I've had it for many, many years, 25 years at least. This is a killer. I shot this for a film at a pig that we dressed up. Obviously, the pig is dead. It had heavy padding and chain mail over the top. And I shot this not a great distance, 20 paces or so. And it went straight through and out the other side. I wasn't surprised until I went to have a look. And a piece of chain mail had looped over the end of this. And the arrowhead had dragged the chain mail all the way through the body, together with some of the padding, and then out the back. All of the chain mail had been torn off and it was still linked to the shirt in the front. This is real ammunition, and it's something I learnt early on as a professional bowman, is arrows. They're expendable. Learn how to repair them. Yeah, they are just ammunition. But I've got some ammunition I want to show you. Yeah, these are originals. So bear with me while I put my magic gloves on. Now, I've got something very special to show you now. It's my leaving gift from Warwick Castle. It's from the young staff there, those who were working during the summer, and they purchased for me this arrowhead. This is early medieval, maybe Saxon, possibly even Viking. We still haven't identified exactly what it is. It's not unusual, but what makes it special to me is those young people, many of them now who are still archers, thought to give me this as a farewell and a thank you. Now, I've got two here that were dug up in France. Here is a heavy bodkin. And it's actually been broken. It's hit something, so it's shattered the socket out. This is really heavy, yeah? And then my pierced resistance. Did you get the joke? This is my Type 14. Once again, dug up in France. But I've got to show you. It still has a piece of arrow in it. And if you look close at the grain, if you can, that is ash. These are my treasured possessions. They're not worth much, but they're what my ancestors shot. So to me, they mean the world. So now don't forget, if you like our little films, thumbs up, subscribe, ding the bell, find out what's coming, and I'll see you soon. Bye now.